They're trying to tell us something. They have figured out the formula for chaos.
When the clock strikes 8:30, babe, time to head for Chris's house.
Hey.
Will the sun make it to the next round?
Oh no.
Pot of thunder. Let's pot tonight. Come on, baby, let's pot tonight.
Yeah, we're back. Back. Doc Gibbs and the Emerald Eye Band are back in the house. Welcome to Pot of Thunder, the recognized symbol of excellence in rock and roll podcasting, brought to you by Blue Microphones. They look great. They sound even better. A lot of anticipation for this one. Here we go.
Chris Jones. The whole world's gone crazy with those smartphones, but there's one thing you can count on: Andy Jones.
Wow. I don't know that one.
That is Why Get Up by the Fabulous Thunderbirds.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
That's going to take the nation by storm, huh?
I think so.
Yeah, I think I'm going to use that professionally. Just drop it in, include it with my resume.
It could work. It's not offensive anyway. There's no cursing or anything like that. There's
a
rant against smartphones in there, which makes no sense whatsoever.
No.
And yet it makes perfect sense.
It can't be better, though.
Yeah, it's perfect. Well, you know me. It's your buddy Andy, America's little brother, the Indiana dream boy, the beef daddy himself. And he's not in the room today, but he's still going to dance for you. Are you ready, everybody? We're going to lay this out on a solo layout for those of you watching via video. Nick's doing something. What are you doing? I guess we're going to find out. Here we go, Nick.
Don't worry about it.
Polka dancing his way across this podcast studio. Look at him go. Welcome, Nick. Welcome
Thank
to the
you
program.
For having me.
Unbelievable.
Thank Look God he didn't put five fingers through that piece of cardboard. You know what I'm talking about.
Wow. Next level.
Which he could have.
Yeah. For those of you not watching the video, Nick is at home today. He's not feeling well, so he's not with us in the room as he usually is. But he didn't want to disappoint there, so he...
slamming down some sort of energy drink. You want to talk about that a little bit? Or maybe we'll get another endorsement deal.
Yeah, I'm trying some strawberry grape body armor.
So how's the flavor so far? I saw you took a big swig of it.
You know, it's an energy drink, so it's not like super sweet. It's got some sweetness to it.
Do you typically drink energy drinks at this time of night?
No, just because I'm not feeling well, I'm having something like this.
But is it like an energy drink with caffeine, though, or is it like a Gatorade kind of hydration drink?
Yeah, I
think it's more of a hydration thing, I think.
I gotta make sure that
I was going to say, you know, when you're not feeling well, I can see the benefit of getting electrolytes and whatnot.
Yeah.
But I don't know about the caffeine or whatever. Yeah.
No, I don't think there's caffeine. I wouldn't be doing that.
Where's the energy coming from? Pure cocaine or what?
I think it's just I think we're using the wrong word. I think it's
maybe
a hydration beverage,
drink,
a sports drink.
Okay, so it's not an energy drink.
I'm sorry.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. But anyway, Nick Pollock has entered the program using a cardboard cutout of a tiny body to dance his way across the studio. There he is, Nick. Welcome to the show. Hope you're feeling better, and I hope you're even better tomorrow and the next day. And each day is better than the last.
That's really the only acceptable scenario at this point.
Mm-hmm. Well, Nick, got to cut you off because he's not sitting next to you, but you own him. We got him.
Get out of my way, yeah, fuck you.
Put your hands together for the breakout star of the podcast, Medium. Chris L's in the house. We are Pot of Thunder. We're ready to go.
Yeah.
It's March already. What is it? March 4th?
March 4th.
Oh, yeah.
3-4.
Mm-hmm. Big day. It's coming. I don't know what it's going to be.
Something's coming.
Something's coming.
March 5th, specifically, is coming.
It is.
Unless the world ends on March 4th, then it's not coming.
Then it's not coming. But a very successful February. We got to put it on hold till next year, though. It was a delight, but like we always say, what would a delight be if every day was a delight? Am I right?
You're right.
Yes. In a sense. Well,
in a sense.
Andy is holding something that I fear is not a delight.
But. It's going to be a delight. Well, Nick's not with us, so substitute big treat.
Who wants to eat dainties? Who wants to eat big treats with me?
I saw our dear friend Joe today, and he said, hey, I heard Nick's not going to be there. I got this for you guys. I got you covered. Chris, hold that up. He's got a Dr. Pepper flavored marshmallow peeps. Why do they exist? I don't know, but why not? Because what? I mean,
every company is doing that, from potato chips to peeps. They're weaving in these weird flavors. We talked about this before. This is classic example of the marketing team getting involved in the creative process simply to sell more units. Just makes no sense.
Yeah, but hey, it worked, because who would have bought, well, I don't know, maybe we still would have gotten a regular carton of peeps. I don't think so. I think if they weren't Dr. Pepper, they wouldn't be here with us today. So it worked. Oh, man.
So these would qualify as a dainty.
I guess so.
I mean, dainty is just a sugary treat of some sort, right?
Mm-hmm.
Although, would you say these are baked? How do you make a marshmallow?
I'm sure. It's like a stovetop. I'm sure Alfonso Ribeiro has covered that.
Why?
Yes. Why?
Well, didn't he host? What was that show called? Unwrapped.
Did he host it after Mark Summers?
Mark Summers and then Alfonso.
I didn't know. I didn't watch it after a certain point.
Guess what? Alfonso hosted everything.
Of course he did. He's the number one host.
If he wants it, he's doing it.
Yeah. Wow. Well, I know you make a marshmallow like on a stove top, so I don't know if that's... is this a cooked treat instead of a baked treat? It doesn't go in the oven, so I don't know. Anyway,
no, I gotta say I didn't hate that.
No, it wasn't bad, was it? I took one bite. I liked it quite a bit.
Yeah, it's not bad. The smell's a little off-putting.
Well, the taste is delightful.
I gotta say I didn't hate that. Didn't hate it at Mm-mm. all.
I'm gonna have another one.
There you are.
I'm gonna have
take a whole row.
Give me
a whole row.
I'll take the other row. Yeah,
they all stuck together, right?
Yeah. Yeah, there's five in a row stuck together.
Have you ever put them in the microwave?
They get big.
Yeah, they get big and then they just deflate.
Yeah, it's not a great idea.
No.
Don't recommend.
Yeah, don't go putting your dicks in the microwave expecting a similar result. Okay. Yeah, we don't want your legal team coming after us. You know, don't treat your unit like a peep, even though it's probably been called that more than once. Keep it out of the microwave. Don't wrap it in foil, whatever you do.
Yeah, that's no good either. Don't do that.
Oh, my.
All right, Nick. Mm. So what's going on over there? It's Chris's pick, huh? Chris is picking off the listener submission list today.
That is correct.
Okay, so we're going back to normal, I guess you want to call it. Let me pull up all the information we need here. Oh, man, let's see how many, quite a few submissions. We've had a month off of the list. So Chris is going to be choosing between the numbers of 39 and 39 and 1,107. So
that's not bad.
Yeah, it's a pretty big, spread here.
I got close to 100 more.
So there's just two choices, and you're picking one of them.
It's one or the other. No, I said between the two.
All right.
I meant like the range of. It would be funny if it was one or the other.
I thought you were just like, hey, it's one of these two. Okay.
Okay, it's either. Well, you can imagine who the last artist is, probably.
Warren Zevon.
It's not last name first. Well, okay.
Warren's even.
Still. Okay, so is everybody ready?
Mm-hmm. We got to boot up the...
we're going to fire
it up. The mechanism. Nick? It's been on a trickle charger for the past month.
Yeah, I've got a remote
control. You got a Bluetooth remote over there?
Yeah. I'm ready.
All right, Nick, pull it. Wow, pulling a pretty early number. Excuse me, number 87. I got some peep in my throat.
There you go.
Just a little bit. I think it sounds a little funny. Well. Let's see. I'm going to send this over to Chris. We got number 87. Okay. Oh, don't do that. Here we go. Nick, entertain everybody.
Oh, let's see here. 87. Got to start with an A, right? You would think A or B. What can it be?
You would be correct. And we'll see what Chris thinks of that. It's in his phone inbox right now from me as he thinks it over.
I'm going to Bushwick that one. Straight up Bushwick it.
Move along to the next trick.
That seems like a fair idea.
Nice and decisive.
With him on that one.
Junk it.
At least for today.
Get rid of it.
Nick, we're going to need you to pull it again. Number 712. Oh my God, I can't spell that. Okay. Even though I'm reading it, I can't spell that.
Year 712, by the way, also a leap year.
Really?
We're currently in one, so that's a good omen, possibly.
This is going to be a bitch. It's going to want to autocorrect this. Here we go.
Send whatever it autocorrects.
It's one of those goofy names, not a regular word. So it's in Chris's inbox. He's thinking about it. We'll see what he says to that.
I can't wait to hear this pilfer song.
I'm going to Bushwick that, too.
That, too, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, that's fair.
Move along to the next trick.
So I'm going to see what comes up out of the pull, and if I don't like it, I'm going to get up off my butt here and march over there and do our new sort of alternate picking technique where I just look at the rest of the sheet that's visible on your screen.
Yep.
And see if I like anything off of that.
Okay. I think that's a good idea.
That's the way I'm going.
All right, Nick, one more final pull, please.
I don't have any more in me. I,
all right.
Okay.
I'll do it. Okay. So the number we got is 307. 307. I'm going to send the title to Chris now.
307.
Hey, you son of a bitch. I'm sick of the autocorrect.
I hate autocorrect.
Isn't it the worst?
You can never fully shut it off either.
Yeah.
Fucking computer nerds forcing their bullshit on you. Just get out of my life. Seriously. It shit switches on that you don't want it to switch on.
Yeah.
Autocorrect being one of them.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, no. just let me have my settings, you fucking dickhead. Just, you know, get over the fact that you were shoved in lockers throughout your high school career. You know, go to therapy. Don't passive aggressively take it out on me and everybody else on the planet by having things turn on and off at will. Enough of that. And stop with the autocorrect.
Yeah. Every time there's a new update.
Fuckers.
I don't know how your phone is. You're not in the iPhone cult, but every time there's a new update, there's always some new stupid thing that you have to go find out how to turn off. Updates overnight when you're asleep, and then there's some dumb thing.
It really is. It's just maddening. I'm going to go with this one. I've got my reasons, and it checks most, if not all, of those boxes, so I'm going to go with it.
You're going with it.
I am going to go with it.
Okay. so you don't have to get up and come over here.
Did you, what was the number of that one?
It was number 307.
Did you do any research, Nick, over there?
No, I'm afraid I didn't.
Okay, hold on a minute. Gotta do everything on this fucking show.
Not a leap year.
Debating. Not a leap year. It is leap day as we're recording this.
Yep.
That is correct.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Boy.
4 years ago on this very day. Didn't we talk about that last episode? 4 years ago today, the 29th, going into the morning of March 1st, we recorded the Aerosmith Classic Albums Clash Talk is Jericho episode. Something that we don't remember for Pot of Thunder. And then the Iron Maiden Where Eagles Dare for Pot of Thunder.
That was on a leap day.
That was leap day. Yeah. By the time we got to the Pot of Thunder songs, it was probably March 1st already, but it started, the recording session started on Leap Day, the very end of it. Yep.
Hold on a minute.
Chris has got something cooking over there.
Literally nothing happened in the year 307.
Yeah, it was why did I add an S there?
No, I think I got it, so hit it.
Abemus Papa.
Time for Pope stuff. Ain't that Pope stuff? Here's some Pope stuff. Time for Pope stuff.
Okay, customary fashion, Nick, any guesses as to who the Pope was in 307?
I'm going to guess Stephen.
Stephen?
Yeah.
Incorrect. St. Marcellus I was elected Pope in 307, the last year of the persecution of the church by Diocletian. He undertook the ecclesiastical reorganization of the church and was most merciful to those who repent after having denied their faith. When certain people known as the lapsi refused to do penance for their apostasy and thus were not pardoned by St. Marcellus, the tyrant Emperor Maxentius sent St. Marcellus into exile, where he died in 309 as a result of privations. What are privations? What does that mean?
I don't know.
We can look it up.
Something else that's interesting here is we've got a subtitle on the St. Marcellus the first page. The patron of groomers of horses. Mm-hmm. So there you go. Interesting like guy.
Wait, the patron saint of grooming horses?
Not a saint, simply a patron of groomers of horses.
But if he's a saint, correct? He's St. Marcellus.
Well, you would know.
He's a patron saint
of horse groomers.
So for all you horse groomers out there,
that's your guy.
That's the guy, Marcellus the First.
Get yourself an icon. Mm-hmm. Put it up in the stable.
Yes. Yeah.
As you're brushing and.
I wonder if that's a brand of horse grooming tools, Marcellus. That's nice.
Should be.
Privation, a state in which things that are essential for human well-being, such as food and warmth, are scarce or lacking.
Okay, so basically just ran out of shit and died.
Yep. That'd be better. Give us a book report on his life. Ran out of shit, he died. That was it. Yeah, it happens.
Literally what happened.
That's it. So, Chris, is there anything you want to say about this song before we reveal what it is.
No, we'll reveal it first, and then I'll talk about it, because if I revealed my reasons for picking it, it would maybe not give away the song specifically, but it would, people would know the band. And so let's just do the reveal, and then we'll talk about it.
Okay. Well, without any further ado, let's turn the microphone over to Chris Jericho.
All right, Harold. This one's called
Stage Fright.
Off of
Pyromania.
By the band
Def Leppard.
Ow!
All right.
Nick, excited?
Yeah.
Is this one you enjoy?
I don't want to get too far.
Okay.
It, but I will say it's a, well, you know, now that I think of it, I know there are Def Leppard fans who, is Pyromania included in the, in some of the, when you've got the Def Leppard fans who are like, no, they were only good the first two albums.
Well,
like, do they give Pyromania some slack? Because I've heard people say that. I frankly think it's ridiculous, but I know people will say On Through the Night and High and Dry, that's it. They haven't been any good since.
I've heard more people give it slack than not give it slack, because most of the songs were written and recorded when Pete Willis was still in the band. A lot of Def Leppard purists say that that their rockier edge was gone when Pete Willis was fired and replaced by Phil Collin. So I've heard more Def Leppard fans give Pyromania a pass versus dismissing it.
All right. Looking back at the submission here, this was submitted by Colleen Houston. What's going on, Colleen?
Wow, cool.
She says, this song has such a cool opening, and of course, it kicks ass since it's by Def Leppard. Oh, she must be a big Def Leppard fan. And this was the song Phil Collin had to play for his audition to join the band.
I did not know that.
Okay.
So there you go. It was already written with Pete Willis in the band, so this would point to it being more in the High and Dry, On Through the Night tradition than what transpired afterwards, so that's interesting. I can say that I have never heard this song, to my knowledge.
Yeah, I don't know if I have either.
Really?
I probably have, but I don't think I could...
I never owned Pyromania. I just, you know, it's one of those albums and bands that, like, were constantly on the radio, and I'm just like, do I really need the album? I'm hearing the songs constantly otherwise. And, of course, I was aware of the fact that there were deep cuts on there that I might enjoy, but I just was never inspired to purchase the album or listen to it all the way through. And that remains true to this day. So, to my, like I said, to my knowledge, I've never heard this song.
Nick, any other thoughts before we crack this open or no?
I will say it's there was a really cool, it was Viva Hysteria. It was maybe around 10 years ago already, or close to it. They did their they did the whole album of Hysteria, but before that, they came out as a Def Leppard tribute act, and they played all deep cuts. I think pretty much all deep. Well, mostly toward the end, they'd Photograph, Rock of Ages, whatever. But and this was one of the deep cuts that they threw in. And I highly recommend if anybody's looking to hear, like, sonically, I mean, it's live, but sonically a more kind of a clear, updated version of some of those deep cuts, that the Viva Hysteria. The disc, well, both of them, but the disc with the deep cuts in particular, really, really good stuff.
What was it called?
Viva Hysteria.
Viva Hysteria. Okay.
Yeah.
I think you played it for me before. That, what was their name as a Def Leppard tribute band?
Dead Flatbird.
Is there a reason for that?
That had to be a Joe Elliott thing. That seems like his sense of humor there.
Okay. All right. Well. You ready to get into it?
Yeah.
Ready to do it?
What else you want to do?
I don't know. This is track 3 of 10, 1983, huh? Good year, big year. A lot happened that year.
Yeah, and we're kind of going rogue here, not scrambling to get Tommy Kotal involved. But so here's the thing. We did Die Hard the Hunter, on the show before.
Oh, we did.
But that was the day that I left, like, right at the beginning of the recording session, because my wife texted me and told us this handyman we hired was destroying my fucking bathroom down here.
He broke the toilet?
He broke the toilet.
That's right.
And this was after I think that was right when I had gotten back from a golf weekend, so I was very sleep-deprived and grouchy, more so than usual. And then I got that text right as we started recording that there was mayhem going on at my house. And I'm like, I gotta bolt and handle this. There's no way I could have sat through and performed in an episode knowing that this idiocy was transpiring at my house. Yes. Andy can relate to that.
Oh yeah, that's fair.
So and that was trust me, on a much more minor scale than what Andy had to deal with. But you know, when you got a contractor at your house wrecking shit. Mm-hmm. You have to intervene as soon as possible. Otherwise, things can really spiral out of control. So I missed that episode.
That's right. Okay. Did you know what it was? I don't even remember how long you were there. You weren't there when we started, right? You were there when we were setting up, and you were gone before we started, I think.
I think so, but Tom was there.
Oh, so I knew
it was going to be a Def Leppard song, but I didn't know which.
Okay.
And then, all hell broke loose, and I had to bail on it.
It's weird that you individually said, fuck each one of us, and then you left. I didn't think that was necessary.
Well, yeah.
I thought there was something wrong at home with the bathroom, but I guess, okay.
I can't keep that stuff bottled up, you know. I just had to release some of the pressure before I got back over here.
Yeah, that's fair. It happens.
Yeah, perfectly good toilet, brand new toilet destroyed by this idiot. It's like, I could have done that. I didn't need to hire you to do that. I could have broken my own fucking toilet.
Yeah, I could have just dropped it out of the back of the truck or whatever.
What was happening with the toilet where it got broken?
He was shitting in it. He installed
it. He took
it for a test drive. what did he do?
It was something about he bought the wrong size, and it was too close. The tank was too close to the wall, and so when he put the rest of it onto the drain pipe.
Yeah.
And tried to force it into place, it cracked the tank. Mm. So,
yeah.
Complete catastrophe.
And Andy had upper tanked it just the day before.
Yeah.
That was a disaster.
No water in there yet?
No. Just turds.
Yeah, so. More than one. I came over a few times throughout the day after each major meal of the day.
So anyway, this is going to be my first official analysis of a Def Leppard and a Pyromania track, and I've never heard it before. I don't believe I've ever heard Die Hard the Hunter before either. So these are some serious deep cuts that we're tackling off of the Pyromania album. So it'd be nice for me to actually be involved in one of the analysis. And after February, people are clamoring for some rock and roll, and I think this checked that box better than the first two songs that were pulled, so I'm ready.
Alright. Well, let's take a quick commercial break. We'll be right back with Stagefright.
Unmistakably Def Leppard.
Yeah.
As soon as all the instrumentation kicks in, there's no doubt about it.
Yeah, that's true.
They were, I mean, I think a lot of it is attributed to Steve Clark, the unique guitar riffs and the parts that
Absolutely,
put into these songs. They were able to accomplish something where you hear it and it's like, okay, this can only be one band, even if you don't know the song.
Well, and it's also by that time the Mutt Lange production had become entrenched in the Def Leppard sound, so that's a big part of it as well. Let's see here, track listing. So this is track 3 on side 1. So mm-hmm. after Rock Rock Till You Drop and yeah. Photograph. So vocally, I heard hints of Brian Johnson.
I was going to say that a little bit in
Joe's
that.
Voice.
Yeah.
And also hints of one Chris Jericho, singer of Fozzy.
All right, Hammond.
Yeah, I heard some some comparisons there, so yeah. All good. Mm-hmm. It's the kind of song that, like, that's why I looked it up, this would be a great opener for an album or a concert, and it turns out it's not. It's track 3, so...
It's no wonder that he doesn't sing like this anymore. How can you maintain
yeah.
this type of vocal styling?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I couldn't imagine. Your voice would be completely shot very quickly, I have a feeling.
Yeah, I think we've said this before. I'm sure we have, but I don't think any of these guys intended on doing this for a long time when they started.
I don't think any of them really do.
Yeah.
And it's also part of it is, and it's a good recipe for life if you can manage it. But living in the moment, being like, well, maybe I should hold back and conserve my voice for, the fact that I'm still going to be doing this in 30 years. I mean, I don't think anybody thinks that way or thought that way in their position. It's like, I'm gonna let it rip. I think clearly they knew they were on the cusp of something huge,
mm-hmm.
and it's like, why hold back? And thankfully they didn't. I just don't think that guys on that level are just regular people. When you're in your 20s, you don't think that way.
No, it's just I can do this, so yeah, I'm going to do it.
I'm doing it now, and who cares if it's going to compromise what I can do in 30 years, because who knows if I'm going to even be around in 30 years.
So yeah.
And let it rip right now.
And bands lasted 10 years tops back then. So,
pretty much. Yeah.
No one's thinking about that unless you're the Rolling Stones, there's an exception, but other than that, nobody's, who was around, Nick, the Glenn Miller Orchestra, were they minus Glenn Miller, of course, but
longer than 10 years?
There's no really no previous examples of, everyone quit.
I don't think so.
The Rolling Stones, but.
And it would have most likely been solo acts, I would think,
yeah.
if they were around that long.
Yeah.
Usually not bands.
So. Yeah. So you were just doing trying to do it as good or better than what other people, your contemporaries, were doing. And it wasn't, you weren't thinking about, am I going to be able to do this when I'm 50, 60?
Right.
Yeah, and am I going to still be in this band? Am I going to be moving on to something else?
Yeah, of course. All right, let's see what happens next.
So when they mix it up and it's like not quite as rocking and it's a little more lush sounding and melodic there, mm-hmm. to me that's like just sonically represents the cusp they were on versus, moving away from the hard rocking straight up AC/DC sound to something a little more sophisticated. Mm-hmm. So far this song is encapsulating both. And you know, it's quite a transition to, you know, go from that just four on the floor rock to something a little, like I said, sophisticated and lush sounding. So that was an interesting transition, but it's very Def Leppard to hear that, especially from album three onward versus, you know, the first two albums, which are pretty much just straight up raw rock and roll, but very well produced raw rock and roll.
And they always were conscious of having a hook in the song, even on the first two albums. Mm-hmm. They always would make sure they had a hook in each song. Hmm. So even if it was a bit like, you know, just like the up tempo rock. I mean, Hello America's on the first album. I mean, that could be a country song with that big harmony.
Yeah, that's true. Hmm. Good point.
All right.
So, do you have the lyrics?
Yeah, I have them up right here.
Okay. Any in particular that stood out to you? Because we kind of went through a lot of it, and I don't want to ask you to repeat all of them. Is there about as far as what the song is talking about? Because obviously we're talking Stage Fright, they're a rock and roll band.
Yeah, I don't know. There's some kind of... There's a woman being introduced.
I was gonna say there. It's a, I believe, a double entendre. It could be.
Mm-hmm.
Stage fright.
Like he can't get a boner.
Yeah.
This is a very up tempo, hard rocking way to celebrate not being able to get a boner. You think it would be more morose kind of vibe here?
Yeah, maybe he's trying to force a boner with, you know, like oral, and not O-R-A-L, although that would help too, but A-U-R-A-L stimulation, trying to...
Hersheiser.
Right. Trying to force a boner to happen. Is that what this song is about?
We think it might be. I don't know.
Let me look up these lyrics myself.
Well, I mean, I don't remember ever really looking up the lyrics before, but I always got the feeling that, yeah, there was that sort of double meaning.
I didn't, yeah, the first time I heard it, I didn't notice that he used the phrase turtle penis in the lyrics.
Well, that's in the Viva Hysteria version, the live version. Came to them later. All right, welcome to my show.
Yeah, Chris is analyzing over there. I think in the second verse is when the woman... quote unquote, I don't know if it, whatever it is, someone is introduced. So,
well, it's what you're holding out on me while I'm on fire, right?
Something like that.
I don't know. Which,
yeah,
I think I'm interpreting it as the woman is like not up to the challenge. This guy's super horny and she's like not having it or doesn't think she can handle it.
Hmm.
Yeah, I think we had it. Flip-flop there.
That's an interesting technique. She possibly is just not interested in him, but he's instead turning it into, oh, you're afraid.
That could be it.
Yeah.
A little subterfuge.
Yeah.
To deflect the attention away from the fact that he has no boner to work with.
He's got no boner, and his mullet looks like Oral Hershiser's helmet. So.
Like, maybe if I can just, you know, distract this woman and blame it on her, she won't notice that I'm, you know, soft down there. Yeah. Nothing's happening.
Yeah, I guess it's your fault.
Whiskey dick possibly setting in on this guy.
Yeah.
It's a known, established tactic that we've discussed up to as recently as the Color Me Bad episode, where it's like trying to confuse the counterpart in a romantic situation. It could be what's happening here.
I think so.
All this bravado and nothing to back it up, so he's gonna blame it on the lady.
All right, let's see what happens. What do you guys think?
Man, oh man, that's, I'm pretty sure that's Pete Willis. I don't believe Steve Clark was ever really gotten to full shred mode like that.
So we don't think it was Phil Collin yet, because he did some recording on the album, didn't he?
Like, did he really record much?
I don't know. I'm asking. I guess since he was in all the videos, you just make that assumption, but we know that that's not necessarily true. But yeah, Pete Willis would have been the smoother guitar. He would have been the Brad Whitford to Steve Clark's Joe Perry, I would say, if I was comparing lead guitar style. So it would make sense that he played that part.
You know, I guess that could have been Phil Collin. It doesn't specify, I'm just doing a Wikipedia thing, but it says Pete Willis did rhythm guitar on all the tracks. It does not indicate lead guitar.
Okay.
Yeah. There's an interesting, I just remembered it because I'm looking up Pete Willis here. There was a very interesting super group that happened in 1985.
Okay.
Called Gog Magog.
Bad name. Yeah.
Yeah, bad name. Look at this lineup. Paul Di'Anno.
Ooh.
Clive Burr.
Oh.
Yannick Gers.
Wow.
Pete Willis and Neil Murray.
I never even heard of them. I mean, I've heard of all those guys. I didn't know they were in a band together.
And I remember I heard about this a while back and listened to it.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow it's not very good. It's, you think, wow, this is like going to be a gem that you didn't hear about. It just is not that good.
That's shocking.
On paper, it sounds like this is going to be awesome. I need to find a rare copy of this, right?
Oops, sorry.
I mean, I could see how that would underperform, though. Because, I mean, you know, not all these super groups are guaranteed to be good. In fact, most of them, to the purists, aren't very good at all. I generally find them interesting, but I'd never even heard of that that collective. I mean, I've heard of all the guys separately, obviously, but so there's a line here lyrically that I think we should discuss. I think it was just before the second chorus. So I'll read them all here. You come on like a lady dressed to kill. Never thought you could be caught, but you will. A little understanding, a little love. A headline act around the back is what I'm thinking of. He's trying to coax her into a little nothing to lose action. What do you guys think?
I don't understand what he's thinking. If it's not a done deal already, that's not the thing that you're going to want to suggest to try to seal the deal.
No, it's not a spontaneous thing that you bring to the table.
No.
I know you're not really into me, but how about we just skip to something that could be pretty painful for
exactly.
you?
Exactly, yeah. Would you like that? Does that sound good?
The implication here that the way you're dressed is inspiring me to do this to you. That's not a good good look.
No. That's no good.
That's a rough approach there. But like Andy said, this sort of thing's got to be planned out well in advance.
Mm-hmm.
It has to be several stages of consent.
Mm-hmm.
The proper materials have to be assembled to make it work without requiring
provisions,
a hospitalization.
Like
yes,
mentioned a couple weeks ago.
If you suffer from what killed Saint Marcellus, that's going to go wrong for you.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have the proper materials and provisions. So things have to be planned out in advance for that sort of thing to happen.
Yeah.
So.
Mm-mm. Yeah, this is just last-ditch effort.
Well.
Yeah,
it's a lost cause at this point. Let's
say, hey, can I buy you a drink? No, I'm here with someone else. Hey, how about anal? Do you want to try that? What? No.
Yeah, that's
guitar solo. What else to do?
Yeah, that's not gonna get you a seafood omelet the next morning. That's gonna get you the cops called on you. It's probably what's gonna happen.
Yeah, you should be running right now.
Yeah, that's yes, it's.
Yeah, that's practically a threat at this point.
It is. Yeah, what's he thinking? You're going for my head. You're going down. Get good at being bad. You're hanging around. A funny spot asylum. Toys for the boys. No one wants to get the nuts. You got
so he backed off of the headline actor on the back bit and moved on to, you're going for my head, you're going down, getting good at being bad, you're hanging round. A fun-inspired asylum, toys for the boys, love on the rocks, forget-me-nots, you got no choice. Hmm. I don't know, man. Some dicey undertakings going on.
Not terribly romantic.
No. Sounds like a crime is about to be committed at some frat house somewhere. Like a bunch of guys are going to get involved in that.
Yeah, and then the football team is all suspended then for the rest of the year.
Are we getting too dark here, or are we interpreting this legitimately?
Hey, it's a super aggressive song, so no, yeah. I mean, there's definitely a... there's definitely a darkness to it lyrically.
All their wins are taken away for that season.
Yeah.
They're just exhibition games after the findings of the court.
The coach did not break the record after all.
Nope.
There are protests against them. Derek Lutz is pouring paint all over them at the football team rally. It's just a bad scene all the way around.
All right, we got a little bit more to go. Not too much.
Yeah, it's coming to the end lyrically in terms of what I've got here on the phone. But
And I just wanted to talk about the music a bit too. I don't think Rick Allen gets his due. I mean, he's got the gimmick of having the one arm and being able to carry on that way, but I don't think he gets his due as far as being really a good drummer.
Yeah.
Yeah, he definitely, before the accident, he was...
And, I mean, he was able to relearn it and pull it off after that, but I'm like, even at this point, just pretty underrated. In a huge band, but not someone that really gets a lot of credit as being a good instrumentalist on their own.
Yeah.
Quite a good drummer.
But now, make no mistake, these are electronic drums that you're hearing on this album. It's whether or not, this was before the accident, obviously, but these are not acoustic drums you're listening to. So whether or not he was playing an electronic kit or they just, laid him down electronically, he's proven in a live setting he can do it. I mean, both before and after the accident. So that's not a big deal, but who knows what they had going on in the studio. But these are not acoustic drums, so let nobody be fooled otherwise. And as we know, Mutt Lang would do anything to get the sound and deliver the product that he was looking to do, and if he had to just program a drum, use a drum machine or whatever and not have Rick Allen actually play in the studio cuts. It was not outside of the realm of possibility, but
how crazy is it that for Hysteria, isn't it the case that for every guitar chord, they just played one note at a time and he was working off of each note individually, mixing it?
That seems so unnecessary.
I think there's my take on it is there's probably a little exaggeration, some fishtails going on with that. But in terms of how long it took him to put out the album, and other people who have worked with him saying similar stuff, I think it just got a little exaggerated in terms of how meticulous he is about everything being exactly how he wants it. But to say that chords were broken down to single strings, I find that a little hard to believe.
Yeah. I mean, I remember hearing that though, and it's man, oh man, can you imagine that process?
Well, yeah, it's got to drive you crazy, and that they, you know, talking about Steve Clark, he hated it, you know, preferred to play live, you know, he was like as Joe Elliott would say in the Behind the Music specials, he was more like a Johnny Thunders guy, you know, little punk rock, dirty rock edge to him, and to go in and be recording something so polished and precise just kind of scrambled his brains a little bit.
And from what I've heard, is a true story. Big Prince fan, Steve Clark.
Really?
Yeah. Hmm. He used to listen to Prince all the time. I've read that.
He saw potential in Prince.
And, I was going to say, he was a known drunkard, so that explains it.
Well,
that
is true.
Well.
Sorry. I'm sorry. I'd like to take this time to apologize.
To the estate of Steve Clark.
Yeah. We
didn't mean it.
No. That's it. 3:45 seemed shorter than that.
It did.
I mean, that's up tempo. That's for sure.
Yeah, it cruises right along.
Yeah, blazing through that one.
Yeah. So, Chris, you brought this song to the show via Colleen. Your turn to vote: "Sweet Surrender" or "Kick in the Crotch." Kick it off, Chris.
I'm gonna give it a "Sweet Surrender."
It's "Sweet Surrender."
Hell yes.
Definitely rocking, up tempo, and then, like I said before, I liked how he shifted from, like, this song encapsulates the cusp they were on between the first two albums and then what would come after Pyromania. The whole album is kind of transitional, and I think that gets encapsulated within this one song kind of pretty nicely. Lyrical subject matter is a little dicey, but whatever. They're not the first rock band to sing about some such stuff. Again, the reference to Nothing to Lose and other dozens of bands who've sang about stuff and double entendres and whatnot. So, you know, we're not going to impugn them too much, but they were walking on the line of maybe going too far with it, but big deal. You know, it's appropriate lyrical content for the more rocking sections of the song. And yeah, I'd not heard that before to my knowledge, but yeah, I enjoyed it. I think, you know, for someone like me who never really owned any of their studio albums just because they were so often played on the radio, you know, to hear deep cut, deeper cut like that is pretty refreshing and a new discovery for me. So I enjoyed it.
Nick?
Sweet Surrender.
It's Sweet Surrender.
Hell yes.
Yeah, it's easy to forget how heavy Def Leppard can be. Hmm. A lot of times, I mean, they are new wave of British heavy metal. They are one of those bands,
mm-hmm.
one of the standouts, really. But it's easy to think of Pour Some Sugar on Me, whatever, you know, one of the, just their big commercial stuff that came later. But man, they were legit heavy grooves going on, like up tempo heavy stuff, and just Joe Elliott just screaming. a lot and it, this reminds me I was told by our friend Mike Haddad,
mm-hmm.
I believe these were the words he told me. He said, if you ever do Rock of Ages, you gotta let me know.
Really?
He said that's the song he jukes to more than anything else.
He jukes to
that's what he told me.
Wow.
And what
he said, that's,
what does he mean by jukes? Do I want to know the answer?
Just means that, I believe that's just a go-to jukebox song for him.
Oh, well, I think okay. that's a dance word.
Or is it a dance? Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, like I juke to that song. It's
part,
like
of
a,
part of the fun is not knowing exactly.
I'm sorry, I've spilled the beans.
What it meant. Well, it could be either way. But I'm just letting you guys know.
He's physically said, moving to it.
Mike said, if we ever do Rock of Ages, we gotta give him a call.
Mm-hmm. All right. I didn't know that. I didn't know he was into that.
And apparently he jukes to it.
Yeah, he does.
I didn't know you could juke to it.
Me neither.
I know you could jukebox it, but, you know.
Yeah, but scooting around to that song.
So when he hears the spoken word intro, is that like when I hear the drum intro to Caribbean Queen, you just click into action and start running toward the sound the system, source of it?
Mm.
Apparently.
Yeah, I can see that happening.
Oh, it's my vote, isn't it? Sweet Surrender.
It's Sweet Surrender.
I don't think I've ever heard this song before, unless I heard it from that live CD Nick was talking about, because I know you played that for me before, and you said it was on there, right?
It was on there.
So I heard it that way, but yeah, I don't think I've ever heard it in the original context on this album. Somehow, I don't know. I guess we didn't have this album. Maybe we did. I don't remember if we had Pyromania. Did we have this?
No. I don't believe we owned Pyromania, so it was the radio hits and the MTV hits that was what we were exposed to.
Okay, so yeah, I missed this one, but I enjoyed it quite a bit. Like you said, easy to remember or easy to forget that Def Leppard was, you know, a pretty heavy band and can be when they feel like turning it on. You know, you think about all the pop hits, crossovers or whatever, like you said, MTV songs, but they can do what they want to do when they want to do it. All right, well, look where we found ourselves. Who would have thought...
For you!
What? How does that happen?
All right, Hammond! I got a question for you!
I don't know how that... That's the first time that's ever happened. I don't know how that happened to me.
Paul's not happy.
For you!
Paul Stanley needs to know... If Stage Fright is a rock and roll boner, as voted by the three rock and roll boners in this very room.
Well, there's two of us in this
very
room.
This very show. You're right. I'm so used to saying that's automatic. Two boners in the room. One, I don't know, six, 7 miles away, remotely joining us. I don't know how far it is. Something like that. Fully nude in his bath, underneath the bathrobe.
Entirely possible.
You think he has a black shirt? Nope. Body hair.
It's the Mamba juice.
Yeah, it is.
Getting to me. I'm still, I guess I'm carrying over from February some of the some of the passion is still hanging around. Leap day. I'm leaping.
Is your body hair graying yet, Nick?
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. I noticed my chest hair's got some gray in it now.
Yeah. Looks like it's like fishing line after it does that.
Yeah. And it gets longer for some reason.
Well, yeah, imagine how long Nick's is. He's never trimmed it.
Yeah.
That's what he's talking about with fishing line. He could go to the depths of the Pacific Ocean with his deep sea fishing with Nick's gray chest hairs. He could do it.
So does it start on the head and work its way to the chest and eventually land on the pubes? I don't know how the graying process works.
Oh, man.
I guess I'll find out. Hopefully. If I'm lucky, I'll find out.
Doesn't it start on the... It's like...
The temples, sides, yeah. It starts on...
Temples, usually. And yep. Like under the chin, I think. It
goes down, I think. I think there's something biological.
It doesn't really go straight down.
No, like, but I mean, it works...
Sideburns have it, but not as much as down.
But here. I don't think your chest ever grays before your head. Like, I think...
Probably not.
Yeah, I think like whatever's going to turn gray turns gray in the sequence of going down the body. This is my theory.
Is gravity involved in that?
There could be whatever that poison is.
Pigment is subject to gravity.
I guess.
Possible.
A lot of pigment in your feet.
It's like there's a leak on your foot, and it just slowly works its way down.
Is that why old people have such insane looking feet?
all the pigment collected in their feet.
Yeah.
Insane looking feet.
Okay, I'll stop. We have to vote.
That's why people have to wear those, what kind of socks were those that Chris had to wear for the rest of his life?
Compression hose. Turned out to be total bullshit. I tell you about that?
Yeah, you told us on the show.
And I saw that the doctor at the, one of these Mexican restaurants around here just fall down drunk at the bar. And I'm like, okay, that explains it.
That explains everything.
And then 6 months later, his practice is gone.
Wow.
Like, okay, that was bad advice I got from this guy.
Yeah.
I went to the health food store, got some topical ointment, and it was cured in a week.
What a jerk.
It's totally true.
That's the worst doctor.
Now that I'm thinking, that would have been my answer for the worst advice I've ever received. It was just completely off base from a fucking doctor.
And inconvenient. That's something you want to do.
And being told you would have to do that for the rest of your life. I mean, are you kidding me? What a dickhead.
Yeah.
And then the same guy a week later just shit-faced drunk at a Mexican cantina, over-served on tequila. It's like, what a tool.
Well, you're on your last day of topical cream, cleaning it up.
Yeah, exactly.
What a joke.
I had forgotten about that. Well, what an idiotic situation that was.
Just because someone's a doctor doesn't mean they're not going to see something ridiculous.
That's true.
Well, that proved it hands down to me. I mean, it's like, thus the benefit of second and third opinions if you need them. You know, some of these guys just don't know what the fuck they're doing, and I encountered one.
Well, one of Andy's favorite stories. Andy, I'm going to tell my story.
Please do.
I was getting a physical years ago, probably over a decade ago, and so I get the physical, blah, blah, blah. The doctor, I'm sitting on the, the table, just kind of hanging out, waiting to get released. And the doctor is standing there by the doorway. What's that thing in your eye? He says. I said, oh, it's called a dermoid. I'm like, I've had it since birth, He just looks at me and he goes, that thing is going to eat your cornea. And then he bolts out the door and never comes back.
Jesus.
He never came farther than the doorway.
That was the end of my doctor.
You had to pay him money for that.
That thing's going to eat your cornea. God.
He charged you full price for that.
I think I heard a car start like 10 seconds later.
I wonder if it was the same guy who prescribed me the compression hose.
If you didn't look at it, just kind of from a distance, what is that? Oh, okay. And then basically gave me a horror story diagnosis.
He said that since birth. That didn't register with him at all.
No. He wasn't hearing any of that.
Yeah.
That's like something a classmate in the fourth grade would say to you.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Stupidity. That's ridiculous.
That's been my life.
Yeah.
I've heard that. Not my whole life. People have cooled down in adulthood, but growing up.
Grown-ups are nice.
Nicer.
Yeah, unless they're your quieter, doctor and they're full of shit and drunk at a cantina. Anyway, my vote is in.
Nick?
Yeah, mine's in.
Mine is in. What order do you want to go in? The same order we voted in, or?
No, I think I should go last since I picked it. So.
Okay.
Nick, Andy, me. How about that?
Yeah, that sounds good. Okay.
I'm giving it a rock.
No boner.
I didn't think so, but it's. Yeah.
Sorry, I had to pull the boner out from under you if you were one of the. People flying the boner flag. I'm sorry. I think I'm. It says more about me than it does about you. My vote. So
you don't need. You don't need to justify it.
Mm-mm. You don't need my. You don't need my boner. You don't need it.
I don't need it.
No good. No.
I'll just go with my 1/3 of one over here and carry on.
You're gonna have to wear a compression sleeve on your boner for the rest of your life.
Rest of your life.
Yeah. And that thing on your boner is going to eat your cornea if you're not careful.
It's going to eat your balls.
Yeah, right, exactly. And then just walk out.
Oh, my goodness.
Just terrible run-ins with shithead doctors. Of course, it would happen to us. You know? Who else does this shit happen to?
No one.
Dumb compression hose out of here.
I don't want to say who it was in case they don't want this information out there, but someone told me a story, and they said they went to an urgent care because they were around an animal that had I don't even think it was confirmed that this animal had lice, but it was an animal that had been like feral or something. So this person was worried that maybe she had lice, I'll say it's a woman, in her hair, and she went to an urgent care. And from about, I don't know, 8 to 10 feet away, the doctor said, "Oh, yeah, you got it," and left. And then it turned out she did not have it. But, "Oh, yeah, you got it." Didn't check.
I can tell from here.
Yeah, I can tell from here. Oh, yeah. I'm like, I don't get paid enough at this urgent care to... actually check it. I don't want to have a risk of me getting lice, so I'm just going to say you have it for sure and then go with whatever procedure you probably need
to. Yeah, it probably just let's prescribe the special shampoo either way.
Yeah, I think that's
that way
it was.
I don't have to get close to you.
Yeah. That's how it works. All right, well...
Chris, did you ever have a lice scare at your school when you were a kid?
I'm sure we did at some point. Yeah,
I mean, we had a couple of them. Yeah. I remember walking past a kid just a couple feet away from me.
Mm-hmm.
And I was coming back from the bathroom, going back to my classroom, and he was walking toward the office. I'm like, "Hey, where are you going?" He goes, "I got lice."
Oh, man.
I was like, "Whoa."
All right, you stay over there.
Yeah, it's like leprosy back in the day.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I recall a few dust-ups with that.
Yeah.
I remember sitting on a towel in the living room with the pink shampoo.
Just
was
in
it
case.
Pink shampoo?
I don't even remember. Was it in case we had it? Everyone did it because.
Yeah, we didn't have it, but it was a just in case here.
I don't even remember that. Okay.
Maybe it wasn't pink shampoo. I thought it was.
What is that called? I know it's. Whatever. Someone will think of it, but there's a specific thing you go get at the drugstore when you need to kill lice in your hair. There's like a, I guess it's pink, whatever that is shampoo. It's got a name.
It might not have been.
Lice shampoo of some sort. Whatever. Okay. If you disagree with us, we're sorry.
That's just the fucking way it is.
Nick, we need a commercial. Can you make it happen?
I got one.
It's got to be a big one.
Oh, don't! It's going to bring in revenue for everybody involved.
All the revenue's coming. All right.
So much revenue.
Let's hear it.
Oh, get yards of questions.
Motherfucker, I give them.
Swing away.
Yes, chief.
Yes. Nick's favorite part of the show, the Yardo questions. This yard came in this afternoon.
This afternoon, all right.
We know the fellow who wrote it. I don't even need to read them. We're going with it.
Oh, my.
Okay. Just strictly by the fella who's
the fella and his timing. That's all we need. All right, so this comes to us from Corey Morissette. We know Corey.
Oh, yes. One of the hosts of the And the Podcast Will Rock, the Van Halen catalog done Pod of Thunder style.
That's right.
If you're not aware of that podcast or you never heard it, you should listen to it right away. I've been on, I was on one regular episode, and then I was on their wrap up of the Fair Warning album, and I'm slated to be on the wrap up of the Van Halen 2 album, which is coming up soon.
Okay.
But highly recommended. Check it out if you're a Van Halen fan, and I'm guessing most of you out there are.
All right. Question one. Give us an example of a song from the show's history where you thought you'd vote one way, ended up voting the opposite after hearing and dissecting it. Has that ever happened to either of you guys?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It's had to have happened. I mean, just think of trying to come up with an example. I guess mine, the one that's jumping to mind, it was an early one, but... So, coming into the podcast, specifically the Kiss portion, which is the first half of what we've done on here, I'd never heard the album Unmasked. I thought it was a joke. I actually thought that seeing the album cover, I thought it was a Mad Magazine parody. For years, I didn't even know it was an actual album.
Yeah.
And I never heard anything off of it. And then over the years, I'd seen clips of the Shandy video and portions of that, but like nothing else. I'd heard nothing else off the album and frankly didn't hear very good things about it. When we did What Makes the World Go Round, like I was instantly drawn in by that. And Unmasked, aside from Ace's contributions, which are crap, everything else, and Shandy is Shandy, it's fine, but every other song is outstanding. Gene's contributions are great. It was my favorite discovery from the Kiss portion. I knew I hadn't heard it all. I didn't really delve into the 80s albums, but Unmasked was... literally a new discovery because, like I said, for years I didn't even think it was an actual album. I thought it was a parody, the cover of it. And I remember when we first listened to What Makes the World Go Round, I was like, this is pretty good. And I liked all the other stuff aside from Ace's contributions. So I'm a big fan of that album now.
There you go, Nick.
I'm going to go back to the Kiss days as well. And I'm going to say specifically a song that I thought, okay, like, I know the song more or less. And I wasn't terribly enthusiastic. Like, I didn't go into it not liking it, where I was going to vote it down for sure. But when we did Hooked on Rock and Roll, I remember all three of us were just like swept up with this enthusiasm for it. Like, all three of us just were loving it. And I came out of that, like, I remember that episode in particular. I was like, that Peter Criss solo album is not bad. You know, you've got a lot of, well, that's a pretty polarizing album, for sure. But that's, I think after doing that song, that's what made me think, like, okay, actually, Peter's is better than Gene. And I just remember it was that song, analyzing it on the show.
Yeah.
And the three of us seemed like we were pretty swept up and with enthusiasm for it. And it really made an impression on me.
Yeah, I would actually say that the Peter Criss album isn't especially polarizing because most people hated it. So there weren't a ton of people on the side that really enjoyed it. But as we've talked about, Peter was, and to a lesser extent Gene, but more so Peter, he's the one who got the memo about what a solo album is supposed to be. It's supposed to be a departure from what you're doing in your normal gig. And Ace and Peter's albums are great. Or, I mean, Ace and Paul's albums are great, but they're, you know, you could apply a lot of those songs, if not directly, inspired by what was regularly going on in Kiss. Gene went off script a little bit more than that, but Peter just totally did his own thing, and that's what you're supposed to do on a solo album.
That's so right.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. I owned the Peter and Ace albums way back when, and I enjoyed Peter's album for what it was from the get-go. So.
And I'm thinking, I don't know that everybody's on board with it at this point. I think it's one of those things where years later you get people who are like, you know what, I kind of like the album, you know, whatever. And there are people, I think a lot of people are like, you know what, Peter's album isn't that bad. I used to hate it. But I think Peter's pretty vindicated now.
You think so?
I think so.
I mean, it is among us, but I feel like we still hear a lot of people say, they hate it.
Really? People still hate it as much as they did when they were 8 and heard it the first time?
Yeah, I don't know.
The Peter album?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we converted some people, but I think in general it still gets the undeserved flack for not being Kiss enough, which just blows me away. That's the whole point of doing a solo album.
Alright. Question 2. Is there a bit from the show's past, for example, Dr. Nick or the one-star reviews, that you would like to resurrect and why?
The Double Platinum Club was fun.
Oh, that was good, yeah.
Yeah, nothing's really taken the place of it, just kind of doing other stuff now. But yeah, that was fun. Especially, like, if it would inspire, like, a sound clip or something like that that came along with it, or a graphic. I don't know how we would, how it would be incorporated.
I feel like it was especially just it was a perfect. It was a perfect thing for what was going on for us at the time, right?
Yeah. Like,
well, and I don't know how you would resurrect it. You had to, and by you, I mean Nick, would have to come up with a new merch item every week, and somehow he was able to pull it off. So, you know, easy for me to say bring it back because I didn't really put much effort into it, but yeah, I think that was specifically tied to Kiss, and when we were done with the Kiss portion of it, that had to go. So
there was always that little bit of hope before Kiss ultimately was thrown in the towel, I believe. Now, There was always that little bit of hope that they were going to release something, maybe. And then we could briefly go back and do that, whatever album, EP, even a single. We could do it the old-fashioned way, but they never came out with anything.
The only thing that was new was that crossover with that Japanese pop act, right? Wasn't that during the show or no?
The last song that Kiss released, well, not really released, but that they recorded and it was put out was Don't Touch My Ascot.
Yeah, right.
Which that's, you know, strange that that's the way that they seem to have gone out. But with the Double Platinum Club, there were a few people over the years who said, for the longest time, I would look up the items and see if I could find them, like on eBay or something like that.
How can I find any of these?
I love. They were exclusive. I loved hearing that. Yeah, there were a couple people who told me that. Like, oh, that's awesome.
How many times did you think of one of those items on the drive over to the house?
Probably a couple times.
I think mostly
I had it. I would have it on my phone. I'd open a note.
Anytime you thought of something,
I would try to bank whatever. Yeah,
that's smart.
Probably still have it, actually.
Yeah. All right. Chris, was there something?
Yeah, I've got a couple. So first for me would have obviously, well, maybe not obviously, but the top of mind for me would be the original songs we used to collaborate on. Now, we're kind of scratching that itch a little bit with our Andy theme songs that we come up with every week that we want to get to 64 so we can have a bracket for those and find out what to the listeners' favorite Andy theme song is. So we're determined to get to 64. But in terms of, like, you know, the Do You Want to Touch Me Now and Who's Coming With Me and stuff like that, those kind of collaborations, it would be nice if we could get something like those rolling again. And then second would be the Nick's original video clips on YouTube with the Then She Kicked Me, the 5 minutes alone one that got taken down because we had a copyright infringement with some WWE footage that was included.
Is that what did it?
Yeah, that was it. WrestleMania footage, I guess, with Hulk Hogan in it. Okay. But, you know, the collision course to the Escape from the Island, stuff like that, you know. Those things would, if we could somehow work them back in from an effort standpoint, because I know it takes effort to do both those things, and again, similar to the Double Platinum Club, the video clips are almost entirely on Nick's shoulders, and, you know, people have lives and things to do outside of the show. But there's some classic stuff in those original videos that Nick used to make. And then I thought our original songs were quite good. So that would be my answer. If you guys are mad at me for answering that like that in the public on the show, take it out on Corey. He's the one who asked it. That's the downside, Andy, of not reading the questions before you dump them out there.
I think we're two for two so far.
I do want to point out that probably the most beloved original video was done by Andy. And we all know what it is, but I'll say it anyway. It would be Hotter Than the Grape.
Oh,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
that was,
yeah. That's
Lightning
that's
in a Bottle.
Yeah, far and away the favorite of everything.
Yeah, put that in the hopper. The Here I Go Again karaoke clip. I mean, the list that goes on. We haven't done one of those in a long time.
Yeah,
and by we,
years.
I mean you guys, because again, you guys were the ones who did most of them, but if you haven't explored the YouTube channel, I think I've put since we have our episodes on YouTube, if you go to the videos tab of our website, Pot of Thunder, you can, the ones that are loaded up on there are the ones that are just more like comedic vignettes versus entire episodes makes them easier to find. Some great stuff on there.
Absolutely. Question three. Ooh. Could you give us podcasters who look up to a piece of advice, something you've learned during your 550 episode history that would be useful for new podcasters to know? While you think about that, thank you for this amazing show and for absolutely killing it for 550 episodes straight. Thank you, Corey.
Piece of advice. I would say that, and I think we've gotten away from it, but I think we don't necessarily need it because we've gotten better at the technical side of it. But I remember in the early days, someone I know, after listening to a few episodes, advised us to add a compressor to the signal chain. Evens out the volumes between mics, so if like someone's talking louder than somebody else or softer than somebody else, if you had some compression in the signal chain, it evens out those levels, so you don't have to be constantly working faders and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So that would be the one piece of equipment that I would recommend people are new to the game to incorporate into their rig. Until they get a better handle on it. And then, you know, we were lucky enough to get this equipment endorsement, but you can never go wrong with having quality microphones.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the microphone is everything for a podcast, really.
Yeah.
And I think we've been doing it for 10 years. Podcasting has blown up. I think there are so many companies that are putting out podcast-specific microphones that it's easy and not that expensive to get something pretty quality. So, say good mics and a compressor unit of some sort, and you should be good to go.
Nick?
I guess something that I discovered pretty early on was... You want to try to like script as little as possible. Like, say, like if you're researching something that's different, but if it's like, say that you, say like for the double platinum club stuff, nine and a half out of 10 times, if you're looking at it, you typed it out, it's great, it's funny, it's going to get a laugh, right? You're reading it off your phone, it never gets a laugh.
Yeah, that's never. True. I don't know if that's exclusive to us or if that's everybody, anytime I thought I have something that's going to slay the room that I brought with me from earlier in the day, it usually doesn't.
No, it doesn't. But if you have it in your head and you bring it out, it can still do well.
Yeah.
But if you've got it worded perfectly somewhere,
no way.
Then it's not gonna. It, for some reason, it just it doesn't. People can tell.
People can tell you're reading a bit.
It's not funny.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, that's totally true. And I guess I would just maybe advise it this way. You know, what we do is everything we do is totally off the cuff. You know, we don't know what's in. Rare occasions we do know what the song is going to be ahead of time. It's very, very small percentage of the time. So we don't know what we're going to be talking about. We're not researching it. We're researching it on the fly if we have to. It's just, you know, if you're over-rehearsed and as we've other things we've talked about, is if you try to do too much editing, it just sounds artificial, and it's just not going to be genuine in this day of artificial intelligence. I think people are already craving that human element, and they can tell when it's just been overdone and over-edited and over-rehearsed and over-researched. And, you know, maybe it's, you know, the fact that podcasting is 10, 15 years old, and And it's, this may be an archaic way of thinking about it, but my attitude is, it should be just as off the cuff as possible, as spontaneous as possible, because there's no limit to how many episodes you can put out.
Yeah.
Just let rip and put it out and move on to the next one.
And one other quick thing I would that I would like to put out there is, and of course, not everybody has this luxury, but I feel like for us, we have a big, I don't know if advantage is the right word, but of being able to be in the same room. Obviously not today,
yeah.
But
that is a key. Room, that is key. Yeah,
that's pretty huge. I think if we were doing all three of us remotely doing the type of show that we do, I don't know that it would flow ever.
And that's why it was a tough slog to get through the pandemic year.
Yeah.
Where we were just, every episode was remote, and then, you know, that's when we, up to that point, every time we did an episode with Jericho, we were in the same room with him, you know, hooking up at a hotel after a wrestling event or a Fozzy gig. And we found out we could do it, so that allows us to have him on more often, which we definitely enjoy, but... Like, I'll just pinpoint one in specific, because one of my favorite songs of all time and a life-changing song for me was the Cult of Personality episode. It could have been so much better if we were all in the same room discussing that one. It just, that the significance of that song deserved a better treatment. And I think it this episode came out fine and people enjoy it, but... that one, and then also I now that I'm just thinking about it, the same dynamic, but the Rico Suave episode.
Yeah,
it would have been so much better if we were all in the same room watching the video
probably
together.
Yeah,
but that episode came out great. I mean, it was funny, you know. We had all the funny banter, but I just think that when you're cracking those jokes and in the presence of each other, it's just a different level.
Yeah. And none of us were together for some of those, right?
Yeah, no, we were all none of us in the same room.
It's crazy.
It was just weird. And we all did what we had to do, podcasting and otherwise, to get through that bullshit associated with the fucking pandemic.
Crazy.
Weird times, but... But yeah, that's a good point, Nick. If it's possible to swing it, it does make a difference, I think.
All right. Well, thank you, Corey. Yeah, I'm a tired boy for some reason.
He's got to take his native sweater and go lay down.
He needs some of that Kobe Bryant energy drink you're sucking down over there.
Yeah, I do. All right. Well, thank you, Corey, for your Yardo questions. Look forward to some more Chris appearances on your show.
Yeah, they're coming up. I will alert everybody on social, but they've been kind enough to invite me on, and it's a great show, and they do it pot style, how we did the Kiss catalog, all at random, doing everything they Van Halen put out, so definitely check it out.
Very cool. All right, guys, we're back. It's March. And guess what time it is, Nick? It's time to get in that bed.